Good morning, and welcome to Western Reserve United Methodist Church, and we welcome any guests who are worshiping with us today and those who are worshiping with us this morning online. Doug and Diane Price have a stewardship moment that they would like to share with us this morning.
All right, I'll go ahead while he's coming up. Good morning.
Good morning.
I grew up in the Methodist Church. We went to church every week. My parents were very active in the church, so that was the example that they set for me. So I've always felt like I belonged in the church. I felt at home in the church, which makes sense because it seems like I'm always here. And Nancy Jarvis was saying last week how the church has been like a family to her, and I could relate to that because neither Doug or I have family in the immediate area. His family is in Pennsylvania. Mine is mostly in Indiana and Massachusetts. So for us, the church is our home or our family here. And I believe that we've had lots of opportunities for fellowship, for friendship through the church, women's groups, men's group, choir, Bible studies. But even more than the fellowship, the church is important to me because it allows me to be part of the body of Christ. And the Bible talks a lot about how the church is the body and we're all a part of it, and the church needs all of us to make the body complete and to make it effective. And working together through the church, we can do so much more in service to God than we can do on our own. And we can have fun doing it too. I mean, what's more fun than being in the kitchen all day with a bunch of other ladies making pumpkin rolls? Right, Suzanne, Debbie? We do have fun, and the money we raise is given to agencies who help the needy in our community. So working together with fellow believers to make a difference in the world, that's a big part of what the church means to me.
I'd like to share two stories with you. It was about 9 years ago, almost to this day, and I was sitting at home alone and having to write the eulogy for my father who had just passed. And it was a real difficult time, and then Pastor Russ gave me a call. He heard the news and giving me encouragement and such. And that next day at my father's funeral over in Conneaut Lake, Pennsylvania, Russ was there. He came there because he wanted to show his support for me. And then that Christmas, and you know, the Dorr family, remember the Blue Christmas service? And we were there, and Russ gave a special service just for people who lost loved ones that year. And it's that connection with the church and knowing that you're not alone. And just 2 weeks ago, Laura and Doug led a group of people over to Debbie's house. And there were 20 of us standing in the yard praying for your husband. For John Cotton, and that's what the church does. We're not going to go through life without having problems, but you don't have to go through it alone. And that's why, people give to keep the lights on and for programs and stuff, but we give because this is, you know, where else are you going to be? This is where, like, our friends are. Our family is now this church. And having this here allows us to get through these hard times that we're going to face, knowing that we're not alone. And so we continue to support this church, and I hope that you recognize that it's more than just coming here on a Sunday and for a worship service, but there's a lot more. And knowing that you are part of God's family. So that's why we continue to support this. Thank you.
And all God's people said, amen. Thank you so much for that. Our coming up this week, the sewing group and has several handmade items that are available for sale after the worship service today. Those items are in the narthex. Also, on the men's Bible study is meeting on Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock. That will be in the fellowship hall. Tuesday morning at 9, Helping Hands and the sewing group are both meeting. And there's a Bible study on Tuesday evening at 6:30, and Toggle meets at 7 o'clock for rehearsal. On Wednesday, our choir rehearsal is at 7:30, and the men's breakfast will be on Saturday morning. That's at 9 a.m. Also, if you ordered pumpkin rolls, you can pick those up after the worship service today. There are many things going on during the months of November and December, and the information about those is in the bulletin. Just a couple things I want to point out that you'll find in there. Information about the children and youth Christmas play. Also, our need for people to help count the offering on Sunday mornings. The Helping Hands Christmas party. The cookie walk. How to sign up for altar flowers. Helping Hands collection of winter boots and winter coats, how to order poinsettias for Christmas, and a reminder that the Operation Christmas Child boxes need to be turned in today, along with $10 for postage for those. There's also information in the bulletin about our Christian education ministry and the Christmas cantata and the drive-through dinner on December the 8th. Well, at this time, let us become centered and prepared for worship as we listen to the prelude.
Good morning. How can you not be happy and thankful that we have a church like this? The boxes and that in front, what we're doing for everybody. I could almost break down right now. It sounds so good. So let's get down to business, I guess. We're going to our call to worship today. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. We belong to God. When we feel overwhelmed by life, God is on our side. When we are afraid,
God will keep us safe.
Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Blessed be the Lord. Heads in prayer. Loving God, call us together as your people, transform us with your love. Transfer our hearts that we may love generously. Transfer our eyes that we may see your grace. Transfer our hands that we may serve others. Transform our spirits that we may be the body of Christ, gathered to worship and send out to serve. Amen. Now we'll do the children's service. Everyone sit down.
It is now. Good morning. Okay, so this is, what does this look like? A recipe book, yes. So we use a recipe book to make food, and hopefully we make food that's healthy, possibly, not all the time, but that's kind of our goal, to help us grow, you know, not grow, but grow healthy. So, okay, so inside here are a few healthy things. What are these? Can you see? Blueberries. Blueberries, this is the big fruit right here. Gotta eat blueberries, right, adults? Blueberries are really good for you. Really good. Okay, I'm gonna try one right now. Mmm, so good. They're little, so you can't eat just one. Don't you wish you had one? I'll let you have some after. Anyway, they're small, but they're so good. There's something else that's small. Where'd you go? It's called a mustard seed. You see it in there? It's so small. And Jesus teaches us, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you can move mountains. You can do big things. A mustard seed, although it's very small, like, what is it, 1 millimeter, it grows 30 feet tall. 30. If we stacked all these boxes up, that'd be about 30 feet tall. Maybe, maybe not. That's big. That little seed. So that's what I'm saying about your faith. Even though your faith might be small, you can do big things with it. That's what Jesus wants us to do. He wants us to use that small faith to do large things, big things. So here's what I'm saying today about big things. How many boxes do we have here, Daphne?
56.
We have 56 boxes that you all packed so we can send them off to places where children probably would not have a Christmas gift. So isn't this wonderful? Right, Bob? This is wonderful. I love it. Thank you, everybody. Give yourselves a hand for all those boxes that you packed. So what we thought we'd do is have a prayer, because we want to pray for the children that are going to be receiving one of these boxes, that they invite Jesus and that mustard seed of faith into their lives. Do you need this? Okay. Okay, let's bow our heads to pray.
Yes, yes. Just a quick word before we pray. We, many of us grew up singing that old hymn, "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love." And we know love is a word and love is a verb. It's an action. And this is one of the ways we show that verb in action. As people receive these gifts, hopefully they will also come to know the God who's behind the giving of these gifts. So let us dedicate these to God. God, there are many ways we are called and invited to share your love with others. And one is through sharing that gift of Christ's love in this upcoming Christmas season. God, your love was made known through word, but also through acts of love, including these boxes that will be received by children throughout the world. May they come to know of you. May they come to know your Son, Jesus Christ. May they come to know of your great love for each and every one of them through these gifts. Bless those who give them. Bless all who will receive them. For we dedicate these gifts in Christ's name. Amen. This past Friday, we as a nation celebrated Veterans Day, a day to honor and extend our appreciation to those men and women who have served in our armed forces. And Harriet has come forward to help us honor a member of our congregation, Isla Cochran, who faithfully served our nation during the Second World War.
We are honored to have a veteran of the Second World War in our congregation, First Lieutenant Isla Emmett Cochran. Isla was born in near Bowling Green, Ohio, on February 1st, 1919. She entered active duty in the Army Air Corps in May of 1943 at St. Petersburg, Florida. From there, she went to North Carolina and to be shipped out to England, going from there to France, taking care of wounded soldiers. She told many stories to her children, her sons, about taking care of the wounded soldiers that they used their helmets as a wash basin to wash the wounds. They didn't have bandages. They would tear clothing up to use for bandages. When the war was over in 1946, she met up with her brother and her brother-in-law in Paris before she shipped back from England. There wasn't the communications we have today. She didn't even know until she found out they were in Paris if they were still alive or not. She came back and went back to Ohio State University and met James Cochran, who turned out to be her husband a few months later, or a year later, rather. And Jim was a sergeant in the U.S. Army. Her family was always dedicated to the military. Her son James was in the U.S. Air Force. When she was in, it was called the Army Air Corps. We didn't have an Air Force at that time. And her other son, Don, was a third-class petty officer in the U.S. Navy. At 103, we are honored to have her among us. Out in the Northex after service, she's brought our album of pictures that were taken from the time she was in nurse's training all the way through her service. She'd be thrilled to have you stop and ask some questions and look at her pictures. But we're here to honor Isla, excuse me, First Lieutenant Isla Cochran. Thank you.
Would our other veterans who are here today please stand? We have a gift that the ushers would like to bring to you. So if you're a veteran, would you please stand that we might bring you a token of our appreciation and also extend our thanks to you for your time of service.
We are thankful for our veterans. Let's close our eyes and let us offer up a prayer of gratitude today. Dear Lord, today we honor our veterans, worthy men and women who gave their best when they were called upon to serve and protect their country. Those among us for whom we are grateful, and others passed away yet abiding in our hearts. Veterans who bore their load in the heat of strife, who fought and fell. They gave all of their tomorrows so that we might have today. Others returned home injured. We pray for them. Only you know how many have memories too painful to share. We pray for veterans who performed their duties honorably and capably in assignments away from the front lines in all branches of the military. All veterans in times of war or peace. We pray that you will bless all veterans, Lord, for their unselfish service. Bless them abundantly for the hardships they faced, for the sacrifices they made. We respect them. We thank them. We honor them. We are proud of them. And we pray that you will watch over our veterans. Grant them your peace. And may the peace you left us, the peace you alone can give, be the peace that sustains, the peace that saves us. Make us good stewards of all you have given. Christ Jesus, hear us. We pray for peace in this beautiful world. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Don. Would our ushers please come forward at this time for our morning presentation of our tithes and our offerings. Loving God, we thank you for who you are and for the very gift of your presence in our lives. And God, we thank you for the many ways you bless us with gifts that are too numerous to count. We know, God, these gifts are not given just for our own benefit, but you trust us to be good stewards of these gifts, that they may not only bless our lives, but bless the lives of your children throughout the world. God, we give these gifts today, and we ask, God, that you use these gifts to spread your love, to spread the hope we have in Jesus Christ to your children everywhere. For we give these gifts, we dedicate them in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated.
On both our readings today, when I was going over these, I thought there's a lot of things you can talk about and what you can say about them. But the one word that really comes to light is commitment. And lo and behold, the sermon is commitment. So this will be interesting. So as I read the words, the first reading is from Romans 12, verses 1 through 2. Let them sink in just a little bit. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and blessing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good blessing and perfect will.
For our prayer concerns this morning, I ask that you keep our Staff Parish Relations Committee Chairperson, Holly Schaefer, in your prayers. She has injured her back. Also, if you'd remember Chuck and Donna Blyler, both of them have COVID right now. And Chuck is going to be, was just recently moved to Shepherd of the Valley Care Center in Poland. Also, please keep John Caroline in your prayers. That's Harriet's son. He has some surgery coming up in the next couple of weeks. Please continue to remember Verna Neal in your prayers as she recovers from a time of illness. Also, Sharon Barnabas, as she recovers from knee replacement surgery. Joyce A., who just got out of the hospital last night. It's good to see Dave Kramer with us this morning. He's come through a time of illness and glad to have him back with us. Also, please keep Bob Kamenitsa in your prayers. Bob is in hospice care, so please keep Bob and his family in your prayers. Also, we want to remember the family of John Meredith, whose services will be held this next Saturday. And please keep also in your thoughts and prayers those members of our congregation who are receiving treatments for cancer, Judy Davis, John Cotton, and Linda Miller. And may we be also very mindful of those whose lives are greatly affected by this time where we're experiencing global inflation. Are there any unspoken prayer concerns this morning? Thank you. Loving God, in whose presence we find help and healing throughout our lives, we thank you for the many ways, God, you provide for our needs. in the way you bless our lives in such a way, with such abundance, that we're able to reply and to respond to the needs of others. For the ways you entrust us, for the ways you bless us, that others may be blessed through our lives, we give you thanks. Especially as we remember your children throughout the world who have become victims of this time of global inflation. God, help us to hear their cries for help and to respond with your grace, to respond as you would compassionately respond to their needs. God, as we gather today, we're thankful for your calling upon each of our lives to be your agents of love, to be your agents of transformation to all the people that you send our way. And God, as we gather today, we also pray for the leaders of your church throughout the world. Especially we today remember our own Bishop, Tracy Smith Malone, and our Superintendent, Abby Amen. Lead them, guide them, empower them, Lord, to lead others as you do with the leaders of your church everywhere. God, we pray today for those who are in need. We pray for those in need in our congregation. We think of Holly. We think of Chuck and Donna. We think of John. And Lord, we lift to you Verna and Sharon and Joyce. We ask you to be mindful of Dave and Bob. And we lift to you, God, those with cancer. We think of Judy and John and Linda. And God, we pray for those today who grieve the loss of loved ones. We especially remember the family of John Meredith. Lord, in all your ways, let your healing come. Healing broken bodies, healing troubled minds, bringing healing to broken relationships. For Lord, we ask these things as we do all things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray to you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Like I said earlier, we are blessed. Our second reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verse 34 through chapter 9, verse 1. Will everybody please stand? Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life to me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And he said to them, "Truly I tell you, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see that the kingdom of God has come with power." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. In the spring of 1942, four young men from my hometown of East Sparta, Ohio, made their way to Columbus, Ohio, to take the test to see if they could qualify to become U.S. Army Air Corps pilots. A little over 10 years ago, one of the fellows that made that trip, Donnie Hartzell, recalled that rather quick trip they made to Columbus and back. He remembered how the four of them piled into one of the guy's convertibles and made a rather fast trip to Columbus. I say fast trip because I found out on the way down, they outran three police officers. On the way back home, they outran another two. I guess they thought they'd already earned their wings, is the best I can tell. But these guys, all in their young 20s, were just doing what young guys do. Three of them did make it into the U.S. Army Air Corps: Jimmy Ollett, Dick Fry, and my uncle, Gary Patterson. And Donnie ended up becoming a Navy pilot. Over the course of the next several months, they each entered into various basic training programs and then headed off to their respective flight schools. Three of those young men never returned home after the war. Jimmy Ollett and my Uncle Gary were both killed in training accidents. Dick Fry was killed in action when he was flying bomber escort over Vienna, Austria, and he was shot down. Donnie, the Navy pilot, was the only one who came home after the war. I grew up hearing bits and pieces of this story from my mother and from my grandfather, and I have to admit, it was one of those things is when you're a kid, you fail to appreciate what you're hearing at the time. You only realize its value years later. But it is a narrative about dedication, a story about commitment, and commitment not only on the part of those who enlisted, but on the part of their families as well. These young men and their families all understood the implications of what they were doing. They knew there was a chance they would not come home, but they believed in the cause, and they believed it was a cause worth giving their lives for. When it comes to the subject of commitment, I often think of our military personnel. Even those who enlist during a time when our country is not at war, they always know there is that possibility during their time of enlistment that they could be called upon to defend their country. The level of commitment our military personnel take on that level of commitment their family members must also bear, finds some parallels in Jesus' call to discipleship. Jesus said to his followers, if you want to follow me, you have to be willing to take up your cross and follow. You must be willing to lose your life for my sake and for the life of the gospel. Jesus' words have certainly rung true for Christians over the centuries who have sought to follow Christ in cultures that are hostile to the Christian faith. There are parts of the world where followers of Jesus to this day continue to be persecuted for their faith and even put to death. Paul also speaks about a deep commitment to Christ in his letter to the Christians in Rome. But instead of speaking about a willingness to die for the sake of the gospel, he writes of our need to become a living sacrifice for the sake of the gospel, to totally commit our lives to the cause of Christ. This commitment that Jesus and Paul both speak of begins with transformation. Jesus continually invited people to turn their lives in a new direction. He encouraged people to stop trying to set the course for their own lives and instead God to set that course for them. Jesus called those who were about to drive off a cliff or those who are wandering aimlessly down life's road to get out of the driver's seat, to move into the passenger seat, and allow God to take control of their lives. And that is the first step of being committed to Christ, is to allow our lives, to be open to our lives being transformed by Christ. And it's the experience of God's saving grace that moves us towards transformation. Paul's own life transformation began with an experience on that road to Damascus. When he encountered Jesus on that fateful day, he felt called to take on a new perspective, to take on a radical new orientation towards life. In Romans 12, Paul writes that this life transformation begins with a renewing of one's mind. To have one's mind renewed means to no longer be conformed to the ways of our society, as Paul writes. It is to seek to know the will of God, to know what is good, what is acceptable, what is perfect. Paul is saying that before we can live the right way, we have to begin to think differently. We have to begin to understand things differently. He's saying that those who seek to really be committed to Christ have to first and foremost be transformed by God's will. Our minds need to be remade. Our perspectives need to be changed. The renewing of one's mind brings about a new orientation that leads to a totally different way of doing things. It moves us from really acting out of our own self-interest to acting in life instead out of God's will. It moves us from being reactive to the events that are taking place around us to being proactive in our responses. Our focus moves from doing our own thing to seeking to do God's thing in our lives. There was this young woman who grew up in a rather emotionally messed up family, and she went off to college. And during her junior year of college, she came to faith through a campus ministry. And she took her newfound faith really seriously. She was really trying to allow God to remake her, to mold her into God's image for her life, beginning with her perspective and her outlook on things. Well, she prepared to return home for a summer break. She knew that her newfound faith in Christ was really going to be tested when she had to be around her mother all the time, who was the adult child of an alcoholic. This mother continually found fault with her daughter, constantly criticizing her about one thing after another. Where did you get that outfit? It looks terrible on you. I'm surprised you haven't flunked out of college yet. You never were very smart. Do you think you're ever going to find a guy that's going to want you? She'd only been home from college a few days when her mother started in on her once again. Her mom was riding her because she hadn't found a better summer job than the one that she had taken. In the past, this would have sent the young woman to her room crying or else counterattacking her mother and ripping into her. But this time, as her mother criticized her, she thought about how Jesus would want her to respond. And she asked herself, what is good? What is acceptable? What is perfect? Jesus had gotten through to her mind. He was transforming her way of thinking. When our mind is renewed, then our actions can be renewed as well. Paul breaks down this renewal of our actions into two parts. The first that Paul writes about is acting with sober judgment. Paul begins this section of his letter to the Romans by writing, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each to the measure of faith that God has assigned." Paul begins this section of his letter by writing about grace. Grace is God's free gift of love, God's free gift of forgiveness for our every fault. And it's also, we need to remember when we think of grace, it presupposes that we have faults that we need to have forgiven. I like people that are in 12-step programs. I like them because of their incredible honesty about who they are. While they may be on one side of the issue of an addiction, they know they're only one moment away from becoming a full-blown addict, active addict once again. They're one drink away. They're one line of coke away. And it can all begin once again. Paul is saying in his letter to the Romans, remember, you were forever a sinner saved by grace. You will always be a sinner saved by grace. So keep an honest perspective about who you are, remembering always who you are and what you're capable of doing. We need to practice sober judgment. But the second characteristic of renewing our actions that comes about from the renewal of our minds is about understanding that we are connected with others. We are always living in community with other people. And as a person who is in community with others, we're called to love. Paul writes to the Romans, let love be genuine. Paul then goes on to explain what he means by this in the context of his letter. It's about extending hospitality to strangers. It is empathizing with the circumstances of people's lives. It's loving the people that persecute you. It's refusing to repay evil with evil. It is seeking to live in harmony with others, attempting to live peaceably with all. It's about contributing to the needs of others. It's about being in community and connected with others. A total commitment to Christ begins with the transformation of our minds that leads to the transformation of our actions. Jim still has memories of his time in junior high and high school, and they're not happy memories for him. His family moved into a new school system when he was in junior high, and the kids of that community were not kind to him because Jim had a stutter. The kids continually made fun of him. Despite the cruelty of his classmates, though, Jim was a top-notch student. He graduated as at the top of his class and received a full-ride scholarship to college. He went to college. 4 years later, he graduated with a degree in computer science. It wasn't long until he started his own software company, and he did all right. He did all right. Now, when Jim was in college, he met a young woman named Tabitha, and she was very involved in her church. And she basically said to him, "Buddy, if you want to date me, you're going to come to church with me. We got to start working on that method of church growth here." But you know, he eventually started to go to church with her, and while he was in church, you know, he eventually got to the point where he invited Christ to enter into his life. And just as the Apostle Paul talked about, he began to experience this transformation of his mind. And he began to also experience a transformation of the actions and the activities of his life. Well, upon graduating from college, Jim and Tabitha got married, and they eventually moved back to the community where Jim had grown up and spent so much of his life in junior high and high school. Well, Jim was at the store one day, and as he was leaving the store at the cash register, he saw a poster, and it featured the face of a guy he recognized. It was a high school classmate of his who had come down with cancer, and they were doing a fundraising dinner for this guy named Norman. Now, Norman had been a classmate of Jim's and one of those guys who was particularly cruel to him when he was in junior high and high school. He was one of those guys who always made fun of Jim when he stuttered. He would parrot what he had just said and just tried to always humiliate Jim. Well, Jim stood there and he looked at the poster and that checkout line, and his immediate thought was, "There is justice." But then as he made his way to his car, he kind of caught himself and just said, "You know, forgive me, God. Forgive me for ever going there." Then he turned around, went back into the store, and wrote down all the information about the fundraising benefit for Norman. Well, Jim and Tabitha went to that dinner. Jim made sure he approached Norman and spoke to him and shared his concern for his own classmates' well-being. And Jim and Tabitha also made a rather substantial contribution towards his treatment. Commitment to Christ begins with a commitment to being willing to be transformed. It's about letting God change our thinking. It's about allowing God to remind us of who we are. We are sinners saved by grace. It's about making room for God in our lives to transform not only our thinking, but our actions as well. Let us pray. God, we pray for not only the transformation of the world, but our transformation as well. God, change our way of thinking. Continually remind us of who we are, broken people, in need of your grace and in need of your healing. And help us to always make room for you in our lives. And God, allow not only our words but also our actions to be transformed by you. For we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Will you please stand for our closing hymn? You'll find the words in your bulletin as well as on the screen. The Navy hymn, "Eternal Father, Strong to Save." Now may the Spirit of God be in us. The Spirit of God flow through us, that the lives of all those who God sends our way may be touched, might be transformed by the presence of God's love at work in and through our lives. Amen.